Infer about the unknown parameter theta. That unknown is simply one kind of thing that you try to estimate the source from which data has been generated, and you don't know the distribution of that source and from which that has been generated. So what you do, you go through parametric approach. You parameterize. That means you try to come up with one hypothesis. You say that the data might be generated from binomial distribution, might be generated from Gaussian distribution, might be generated from exponential distribution, but we don't know the parameter of those specific distribution. So we are just here introducing some kind of model structure. Due to that, we just need to estimate only parameter involved in that distribution. We don't need to estimate complete density itself directly from the data. That approach happens to be a non-parametric approach, and that one is a very advanced technique. So this parametric approach is what a little bit simpler in order to from we can say that computational perspective, this parameter estimation happens to be easier, because just here we need to estimate only parameter, either it would be mean or it would be variance. So for that perspective, there are two kind of estimator. I told that one is you are directly try to estimate that parameter like mean kind of thing by point estimator like sample mean, or variance with sample variance. Those are point estimator. Now another thing you observe here in last class, that interval estimator, that what you do, you don't go just for point estimator. What you do, you try to say that the true value of parameter may lie in a interval, in an interval. So that one is more reliable than point estimator. So in case of interval estimator, you had already seen that you need to estimate two things. One is lower estimate, another one is higher estimator. So two things at a time you have to estimate for a involved unknown parameter. But what is happening, that we had enough idea about point estimator. So by applying idea of point estimator and idea of central limit theorem, by combining these two concepts, point estimator and central limit theorem, we can estimate confidence interval or interval just with the help of these two. Easily we can estimate. So that time it becomes very simpler. So again, point estimator is playing very major role in case of estimating interval or confidence interval. So confidence that would be given to you, and with the help of that's way another name of that interval estimation. We after estimating the interval, we are calling it a confidence interval. So, because there would be some association with confidence level, or what we call it, confidence property, probability. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would like to discuss about again, I will give overview of that what we discussed in last class, confidence interval, and I will talk about a few problems based on that confidence interval. Afterward, I will introduce hypothesis testing, and this one is really interesting from several perspective and various approach you will see in case of hypothesis testing. So coming to confidence interval, so we had already seen confidence interval. So simply, in order to summarize confidence interval, I would like to talk about confidence interval for a standard, simply normal random variable. I will talk about normal random variable. How, why I'm talking about normal random variable, you can ask. Simply, I told that here we are going to find confidence interval or interval estimation for sample mean, or a distribution, distribution with unknown mean. Mean would be unknown to us. That mean generally we denote it by theta. Theta happens to be unknown to us. We don't know theta. So what we do, in place of theta, we try to come up with one point estimator that we are calling sample mean, happens to be one estimator of theta. Okay, so with the help of this sample mean, we know that sample mean, if you talk about in large sample size, then using central limit theorem, we can say that sample mean, by externalizing, it is converging to normal distribution. So that's why when sample size happens to be large enough, then easily you can talk about interval estimation with the help of normal distribution. Why? Because we know that sample mean, if you externalize it, by how you externalize it, you can deviate the sample mean by the true value of theta and divide the that why we are deviating, because true value of theta happens to be mean of the, or expectation of the sample mean. That's why we are deviating a sample mean by the mean of sample mean and dividing by the corresponding standard deviation of sample mean. what is the standard deviation of sample mean? Suppose sigma is the true standard deviation, then a standard deviation of sample mean happens to be sigma by a square root of n. So in that process you got a standardized sample mean, and it is always converging to a standard normal random variable z in distribution. So that's way, why which rule say that the central limit theorem is saying that. So that's why here just all about, if you try to deal with this sample mean, it is not like that, just what approximately the distribution of sample mean happens to be normal in nature. So that's why we will talk about interval estimation from the normal distribution perspective. So here suppose we are having confidence level alpha, then the selection not rejection interval or selection interval, it would be 1 minus alpha, that we are calling it confidence level. So this is the confidence level, alpha is the, it is talking about rejection kind of things. So 1 minus alpha would be our confidence level. So what is the 1 minus alpha interval for normal distribution z? Normal distribution z, or generally normal distribution we denote it by x, and z is meant for a standard normal distribution. Okay, so generally it is happening like this way. So this is the normal distribution PDF of normal random variable, and this is what this is the mean, and we talk about this is the true value of mean, but this value of mean is unknown to us. So what we do, we can come up with the estimate of this one, interval estimate of this one. So how we can estimate? So we can estimate, we know alpha is given, so the probability of this one, this region is alpha by 2, and probability of this region, that x is this area is alpha by 2, that one is talking about probability that value random variable x is observing value up to xl, that lower estimate. This is talking about, this region is talking about probability that normal random variable x is observing value up to xl. Okay, and what is this one? This one is also same probability to symmetric nature of normal distribution. What does this one? This one is talking about right tail probability, that probability that x is observing value greater than equal to xh, upper estimate. Okay, and further if you try to write it this one, then what would be this one in the systematic in the form of distribution function, you can write this probability, right tail probability, as 1 minus probability that x is observing value up to xh. So those relation are clear, many time I had already discussed, so you can write it like this way. Okay, so this scenario, from here you can conclude that probability of, what would be this probability? This probability would be 1 minus, if you talk about this probability is actually talking about this area. Okay, so from here if you try to conclude what is the probability of this region simply it would be 1 minus alpha by 2. So probability of x, observing x less than equal to sh, upper estimate, it would be just equal to 1 minus alpha by 2. So all the description is given here with respect to distribution function as well. So you can simply, if you know everything about the normal distribution, and what you do with the help of that, easily you can calculate all these required things which are unknown to you. Okay, and what is happening that even if you are having any normal random variable, always you do a standardization. So due to that, you will get this symmetric density with respect to origin. It is symmetric with respect to origin. And what is beauty with this interval estimation with standard normal random variable is that we don't need to calculate lower estimate and upper estimate separately, because due to symmetric, if this is the upper estimate, then negative of that it would be lower estimate. So easily we have to calculate z alpha by 2, this upper estimate, and by taking negative due to this symmetricity of the density of a standard normal random variable with respect to origin, just take negative of the upper estimate, and that would give a lower estimate. So just one, it that two calculation has been limited to one calculation. That's why it is very interesting. And we know that standardization of any normal random variable by to a standard normal random variable, how? So deviate the, suppose x is a normal random variable, deviate by mean and divide by a standard deviation. Easily it will be what? It would be your z, a standard normal random variable. So that a standardization process, you know that. So that's way, if you are having a normal random variable, always do a standardization and get this picture. Because in the case of a standardized normal random variable, just you have to calculate only one estimate. Either so upper or lower. So if you are getting lower estimate, take negative of that, you will get upper estimate. If you are getting upper estimate, take negative of the upper estimate, you will get lower estimate. So that is the story. Due to that, this calculation, it's just very simple. And apart from that, also we are having idea of normal table. From that we can calculate all these value of z, and due to the known value of phi from the normal table, easily we can calculate all these value from normal tables. That's why this here, simply I would like to say that if you come to see here the standard normal random variable, then calculation is simpler to you, very easy to you, you can calculate all this. Now I will talk about the confidence interval with respect to pivot quantity and point estimator. So further, I told that it is very easy to find confidence interval for a standard normal random variable or a standard normal random variable. Basically, it is very easy to find confidence interval associated with a standard normal random variable. So what we do here, if you are having any sample data, that one is coming from any distribution, we don't know that distribution. So what is happening, that from that data, given sample, we try to come up with a pivot quantity, or that one is related with sample mean or a standardized sample mean. What we had already seen, that a standardized sample mean or mean deviated sample mean happens to be a pivot quantity. So come up with pivot quantity, and that pivot quantity, actually why we are proceeding with pivot quantity, because it is a very special kind of a random variable that has been defined from the sample and the unknown parameter theta. Large run of sample size, when sample size is very large, then it is converging to a standard normal random variable in distribution. So that's why it is really interesting from that perspective. And we had already seen that the confidence interval can be also represented in the term of point interval as well. So that's why here, irrespective of the source of the data, we can always find confidence interval in term of pivot, corresponding pivot quantity and corresponding point estimator of the unknown parameter theta. So that's why we try to generalize the results from that perspective. So suppose we are having any question right now? No question. Okay, I'm going forward. So I was here. So suppose we are having a sample of size n, and simply you say that all the possible observation of size n. This is the sample. Okay. All collection of all sample of size n, simply you can say that, and these xi are coming from the same distribution, and hence we say that each xi will have the same mean expectation, that theta is unknown to us. So we try to proceed with one natural choice of a point estimator, that as a sample mean. So, and we know that by central limit theorem, if you define a pivot quantity as a standardized sample mean, this is the standardized sample mean, and then it is converging to a standard normal random variable z in distribution, and hence that's why we are saying this standardized normal random variable happens to be a pivot quantity. That is the property of being a pivot quantity. Okay, so what we do, we are willing to find a 1 by alpha confidence interval for approximate standard. You can say that Q is approximate standard normal random variable. Approximately, it is standard normal random variable. So we try to find one minus alpha confidence interval for Q. How we can find? We can find it like this way. This is the confidence interval. This is the confidence and desired confidence interval for theta with the pivot, this pivot element. We try to come up with this pivot element, and what is the probability of this confidence interval? Probability of this confidence interval is actually the confidence interval 1 minus alpha. The confidence probability, what we are calling it. Probability of this confidence interval, what is the probability that theta falls in this confidence interval? That probability is actually 1 minus alpha. Okay, so that is the story. Okay. regarding confidence interval for any sample coming from any distribution. So that's where now we will try to discuss one example. Afterward we talk about hypothesis testing. So here I am taking one example regarding what the confidence interval of a measurement error. So whenever you might have already heard several, whenever we talk about the distribution of error, and then distribution of total error happens to be normal distribution. Why? Thanks to central mid theorem. So your situation is similar to that. So and what is happening? An engineer is measuring a quantity theta with a random error in each measurement. So try to measure theta, okay, with random error, okay. So that simply for that case he is taking n measurement with the average of measurement as the estimated value of theta. So what is the average of the measurement? That theta plus random error. If you take in average, then that would be one estimate of theta. So why? Simply, if you take talk about random error, generally random error for we are taking mean of random error happens to be zero. So if xi is the value that is obtained in ith observation, that means theta plus random error, denote that random error by wi. W is actually meant for white noise, so that's where people are taking w notation. Coming from white word, white noise, but it always happens to be a noise, okay, not a notation for noise. So this is the ith measurement, what we call it ith measurement for theta. Here easily we can say that the measurement include true value of theta along with some noise, random noise or random error, okay. And here wi we are calling it, it is the error in the ith measurement. So we assume that each random error, that wi, happens to be iid. That means independent and identically distributed. That means all the error are coming from the same source of the errors. That means, and with further property that, as I told, that the mean of the random error happens to be zero. So and variance is given, it is equal to 4. So this is the variance and mean is zero. Okay, so in order to, why we are putting this condition? Because if you talk about with this property, if you try to find the mean of xi, then mean of xi, it would be equal to theta. So in order to prove that in the average measurement, it is one estimate of theta. Okay, so the engineer reports the average measurement as a sample mean. Of this measurement, sample mean of this measurement, it is coming. So it is one kind of estimate of theta, one estimate of theta. So we here question is coming that how many measurement does the engineer need to make until he is 90% sure that the final error is 0.25 unit. So that means your confidence level, that means 1 minus alpha is given 90%. So that you have to find a confidence interval with confidence level 1 minus alpha. That you have to find it. And what is the probability, service probability of error? That would be less than 0.25. So how we can calculate it? So we can calculate in a very simple fashion, that it is already given that each random error, that noise happens to be iid. So due to the iid nature of the noise, the corresponding measurement xi happens to be iid. So easily we can apply central limit theorem. And also we can easily calculate mean of each xi. So mean of xi would be equal to just theta. So okay, and variance would be what? Variance of xi also, it would be equal to variance of that noise, that one is equal to 4. So we are having known variance of xi and unknown mean of xi. Theta is unknown to us, we don't know that. So natural choice, in order to estimate theta, we have to proceed with sample mean. This is sample mean as a natural choice in order to calculate the 90% confidence interval for theta. So we are going to calculate it. How we can calculate it directly? We can calculate it. We had already seen the estimation process of this interval. We can come up, we know that in last that using central limit theorem, just this would be the our desired confidence interval. And here we are having value of sigma. We are having we don't know here n is unknown to us, and we are having probability. What is the probability? Okay, this value, it is also given to us. What is the value of this? This value is, that means there is situation like this way. This is theta. So I try to come up with a sharize, what we call it, sample mean. So it is having approximately this point would be zero. Better I should not write it here. This point would be zero. Here I am calling it here Z is approximated by sample mean minus mean of sample mean, that happens to be two parameter theta, divided by standard deviation of sample mean, that one is sigma by square root of n. Okay, and this point would be negative of Z alpha by 2. This would be positive of Z alpha by 2, and value of how much standard deviation away from this 0, that value is given, that one is 0.5. So this is talking about rejection region. This is talking about rejection region, and this one is the confidence level, confidence region simply you can call. So this is talking about rejection region, and what is given here, that rejection, what is the probability of rejection region? It is 0.25. This probability is given, it is 0.25, it is given, this measurement is 0.25 is given. That means value of this error, this you can say that this error, it is given here. Okay, so that one is 0.25. So this interval is equivalent to this that sample mean minus lower limit, lower estimate would be given by sample mean minus 0.25, upper estimate would be given by sample mean plus 0.5. okay, and we know that this quantity, it is equal to 0.25, and we have to simplify here in order to get number of least measurement, that threshold value of n. In order to get, so just simplify, all the value of sigma is given, sigma is 2, alpha is, we are willing 95% confidence, the interval, that means what would be value of, this would be 1 minus alpha equal to 90%, means alpha equal to 10%, that means 0.10. Okay, and what we know here, from derivation, also we know that this point is the, this point is Z alpha by 2, and this negative of Z alpha by 2. So from there, easily we can calculate Z alpha by 2. How we can calculate? We know from here. So what does it talk about? So if you try to express this one in term of probability, then it would be Z is less than equal to Z alpha by 2 upper estimate alpha by 2. What is the probability of this one? 1 minus alpha by 2. 1 minus alpha by 2. That means what is the 0.1 divided by 2 means 0.05, and from here easily you can calculate value of Z alpha by 2. What could be that? And what is name of this one? This one we generally we denote it by phi of Z alpha by 2. Phi happens to be distribution function of a standard normal random variable. So from here we will get directly Z alpha by 2 would be phi inverse of 0.95. And if you try to see from the normal table, the value of phi inverse 4.95, it would be equal to 1.64. This is the value of phi inverse of 0.95, and hence we can say that we can say that value of Z alpha by 2 is what? It is 1.645. The substituting value of Z alpha by 2 here in this equation and solving it, we will get that least value of n would be 174. 174. So this minimum number of measurement you need to get an approximate, a good approximation of the theta. This number of measurement you have to perform, 174 measurement. If you are performing less than 174, then it may possible that average value of xi may not match with theta. So you have to perform this. Now this is the thresholding value of n, but we, in order to get a good interval estimate of theta, good interval estimate of theta, you have to perform this number of measurement. Okay, now here we will talk about next hypothesis testing. I will introduce what is hypothesis testing first, and what is the, so generally we will talk about the hypothesis in sense of the binary hypothesis. That means there are only two situations, either this or that, that situation. So once hypothesis, we are calling it null hypothesis, that happens to be a default hypothesis. If we are having a sample, then we try to, what we do, we try to prove or disprove the null hypothesis. H naught, generally we denote by H naught, and other hypothesis we denoted by HA or H1. That happens to be alternative hypothesis. So there are only, that's why binary situation is coming here. So in a binary hypothesis, an unknown parameter theta takes two values. Either it will proceed with H naught, that happens to be null hypothesis, and null hypothesis generally we take as a default model to prove, we have to prove that default model with the basis of whatever sample we are having. Either we have to prove or disprove, that means that data will either support H naught, or either it will, that data will not support H naught. If data is not supporting H naught, then it will, that data, that will, our hypothesis will go with H1. H1 would be alternative hypothesis. If your data is not supporting H naught, then in that case we have to go for H1. So H1 is the alternative hypothesis. So there are only two situations. So suppose we are having available observation, that means all possible samples of size n. So that we are calling it all available observation of sample size n. So whose distribution depends on hypothesis. Hypothesis, and here H naught, it is talking about true value of the, it is dealing with theta naught, that means that happens to be true value of hypothesis. True value of hypothesis, what by default we try to proceed with. So here, so what is the probability that X is coming from as just one region A, and with the hypothesis Hj? This is what does it talk about? It is talking about the probability. If data is discrete in nature, then we will talk about probability. If data is continuous in nature, then it will lead to, it can interpret in terms of density. So the probability or density that the observation X belongs to the region A under the hypothesis Hj. That means Hj it would be either H naught or H1. So that means under hypothesis Hj means we are talking about truthness of Hj. So here, in order to proceed with hypothesis testing, we want to find a decision rule that map the realized value, one realized value of the observation X, simply we denote by X, once sample we denote by a small letter, or simply it happens to be one observation. So we have to come up with one decision rule based on these two hypotheses and based on the given data. So what is that decision rule? Decision rule, it is saying like this way. So you just start with H0, two hypotheses, H0 and H1. Okay, now with respect to H0, you are defining, this is the distribution function. This is the distribution function, or simply you can say that probability density function in case of continuous random variable, and probability mass function in case of random discrete random variable. Okay, now after that you are observing some data from the observation process. You are observing from data, but you don't know the distribution. So one observation you are taking, based on that observation you try to come up with one decision rule, and that decision rule it say that whether you have to proceed with H naught, that means null hypothesis, that means true value of theta, or you have to proceed with something else, alternative hypothesis. So this is the decision rule. You have, based on a single observation, you have to come up with a single or few observation, you have to come up with one decision rule. So that decision rule will define it with the help of likelihood ratio. In later slide we will see it. So a binary hypothesis for an unknown parameter theta, how we define it? We define it like this way, null hypothesis H naught. So what does null hypothesis talk about? It says that the unknown the data coming from unknown source, it is having a distribution p of x, where the parameter is decided by h naught, the true value of theta. True value of theta. Or if suppose the data is coming from continuous source, then we say that the density, which is defined by true value of theta. So h naught, it is associated with true value of theta. And if you are wrong with h naught, then simply we can say that that parameter is not taking true value, it is taking something else. So what is it? That something is dealing with the alternative hypothesis H1. So if you proceed with H1, what does it say? It simply say that this hypothesis say that the data is coming from a distribution where the parameter theta is provided by H1. And simply, if in case of discrete and in case of continuous, the density is provided by H naught. So whatever H naught is, just simply it's saying that it is that parameter is different from true value. So here I will talk about association of decision rule and rejection region. So yes, here rejection region is playing very important role in order to apply the hypothesis testing. What is that rejection region? So rejection. So here. In decision, a decision rule can be represented by partitioning this set of all possible observed value of x into two subset. One subset we are calling it rejection region, and another subset we are calling it acceptance region. So I had already told that if you are having data in hand, then apply central limit theorem, then it will say that the pivot quantity. That means what a standardized sample mean you are defining, then the approximate distribution of the pivot quantity or a standardized normal sample mean, it will have an approximate normal distribution, a standard normal distribution, simply we can say that. So we are having two regions, this region and this region, this right tail and left tail region. So here these region we are calling it rejection region. This value, if x is observing value after this, you can denote it by z. This point would be z alpha by negative of z alpha by 2, and this point would be positive of z alpha by 2. So whatever value of x which is falling right or left of z alpha by 2, right of z alpha by 2 or left of negative z alpha by 2, then those value are falling in rejection region. So this region and this region, including this one is right rejection region, this one is left rejection region, and the region between these two we are calling this one is the acceptance region. So always if you take data, observe the data will either come partition into either fall in acceptance region or rejection region. That is the situation. So this rejection region we denoted by R, this one is also R, and this selection region or acceptance region we denoted by R complement, or this is R complement or confidence rejection acceptance region or confidence region also you can say that. So the hypothesis H naught, it is rejected if x falls in the rejection region. That means observed value of x is in R in the rejection region, then we have to reject our true null hypothesis. We have to reject, otherwise we have to accept. If we fail to prove that H naught, that means x is in R, if we fail to prove that, we don't know that x is not whether in R or not. That means x, suppose simply we prove that x is not in rejection region, then we have to accept H naught. That scenario I want to say that. So the choice of decision rule is what? It is equivalent to choosing rejection region. It is, so how you, what is the decision rule? Simply it is very much equivalent to identify whether the data falls in rejection region or not. Rejection. So it is about your decision rule highly based on decision region. Rejection region, simply I would like to say that. So more in pictorial way we can say that, like this way. So we are having data, this one is the space collection of all data it is talking about, and here this region we are calling it rejection region, this region we are calling it acceptance region, that means R complement. Rejection region we denote it by R, and acceptance region we denote it by R complement. So if data is falling in acceptance region, then we say that H naught is true, we accept X naught. So we accept the null hypothesis x naught. If data we are starting, I told that x naught, that null hypothesis happens to be our default model. So always we start with x naught, and based on data we try to improve our inference. Okay. So if data falls, we are started with x naught, but data falls in rejection region, then simply we need to reject x naught. Simply we reject h naught. So further, if you try to see further, so if you are in a, you started with a null hypothesis h naught and your data support it, that means data falls in rejection region, acceptance region, then what does it mean? It simply say that h naught is true. Whatever hypothesis we proceed with h naught, that happens to be true. That means we are not committing any error. But what is happening that we are started with h naught, that null hypothesis, and what is happening that here we are started with h naught, but the data falls in rejection region. Then what is meaning of that? Simply we are proceeding with type 1 error, and there is a type 2 error. That means simply h naught is false. We come up with h naught is false, but data falls in the acceptance region, then we are coming with we are committing type 2 error. So there are two special kind of error. These two error are very much essential. We need to calculate probability of these two error. So what is the probability of these two errors? So here I will define the types of errors. What are the, there are two types of error, type 1 error and type 2 error, and what are the associated probability. So a particular choice of rejection region, there are two possible types of error. So if you try to choose rejection region, there are two possible error. One error that we are calling it type 1 error, that simply we say that it is equivalent to say that it is false rejection. False rejection, okay. Or for false rejection also you can say that false positive. False positive is, so what is meaning of that? It says that the hypothesis with which we proceed, that happens to be true. Null hypothesis H naught with which we take as a default model and we proceed with, but that one is true, there is no issue. But after validation, what we observe that data falls in rejection region. Data falls in rejection region. Okay, so what we have to do? We have to reject the H naught. Because we are seeing that data is falling in, we are starting with H naught, but data falls in rejection region. We have to reject the null hypothesis H naught. That means we have data is coming from what? Rejection region. So what is the probability of the type 1 error? It would be just what is the probability that X is in rejection region and we are starting with null hypothesis H naught. So this is the measure of type 1 error. Probability, measure of probability of type 1 error. So numerically you can calculate. So it is saying that the probability that you need to reject H naught. Why we are rejecting H naught? Because our data is not supporting acceptance region. Data is falling in rejection region. So that's why we need to reject H naught. Reject H naught is equivalent to data is falling in rejection region. So both are common to each other. And we are here proceeding with default hypothesis H naught. Like one default hypothesis, if someone is saying that, why I am saying that H naught is default hypothesis, like if you toss a coin, then default hypothesis would be what? The probability of success would be 0.5. Why? Because always we consider that coin happens to be fair or unbiased coin. So always we take this one as a null hypothesis or default hypothesis. What would be alternative hypothesis? Alternative hypothesis would be, we never proceed that coin would be a biased coin. So that's where this if 0.4 or point, simply you can write it, the probability of success is not equal to 0.5. That it might be 0.4, it might be 0.7, something like that. So this is the alternative hypothesis. So the null hypothesis is always taking true value of theta, in sense that true what we generally assume. Okay, so here, and this one is the alternative hypothesis, that idea is coming into here. So what is type 2 error? Type 2 errors, or simply you can say that false acceptance. It is talking about false acceptance, and that means it is equivalent to say that false negative. False negative, you can say that. What does it? It is talking about that actually H naught is false. The default hypothesis is false, but we are accepting it. actually as the default hypothesis h naught is false and we are accepting it, then how we can, that means the data what we are taking data falls in acceptance region, and we are saying that we are started with we are saying that h naught is false, that means h1 is true. H naught is false means H1 is true. Simply, there are two hypotheses. So both are both can't occur together. So okay. So it is one kind of theory of alternative. Both are alternative to each other. If H naught is false, then but what does it mean? H1 is true. If H1 is true means H naught is false. So that situation is coming here. Okay. So H naught is false means H1 is true. And the data what we have taken, that false in acceptance region. It is so. What is the probability of, so in this case, what is the probability of error committing error? So probability of committing error, we are proceeding with that. Probability that x is not in the rejection error region with hypothesis h1, that means h0 is false. So this, in this way we can calculate probability of error. Now I will talk about one more interesting criteria to establish this kind of hypothesis with the help of likelihood ratio. So this one is computational approach to compute things here in hypothesis testing. So what does we do here in likelihood ratio test? That means we have to define a likelihood ratio with the help of likelihood function. So suppose how we define likelihood function. So we define likelihood function through this way, that this one is the Bayesian approach. Actually, it is talking about the it is given with given data, what is the probability of H1, if probability, whether probability of H1 is greater than probability of H0 with the perspective of given data. Okay, and if you try to apply Bayes theorem, the what is this one? So this is what, posterior probability of H1, and so posterior probability of H1 can be written as prior probability of H1 times likelihood function divided by a function of observing the data, that probability of observing data. Okay, and likewise also you can apply Bayes theorem here, probability of this prior posterior probability of H0 given data, it would be what, prior probability of H0 into this likelihood function divided by probability of observing data x, one value of x. Okay, and if you simplify it a little bit, just bring this one left hand side and this one take right hand side, what you observe here, so here this term will cancel out, so take this one right hand side, so you are observing this quantity. So we are saying that what is this? It is actually you can talk about likelihood function. Likelihood function of like to, with respect to alternative hypothesis H1. This one is likelihood function with respect to null hypothesis H0. So ratio of likelihood function. This, so that's why we are saying that it is a likelihood ratio. And this, if this ratio is greater than this quantity, this one is threshold value, then we proceed with H1. We proceed with H1. So that scenario is coming. This one is simply likelihood ratio, what I would like to say that. So this one was the perspective of Bayesian approach. That means when we observe H1, that parameter, when we proceed parameter as a what we call it random variable. But in case of that classical approach, that theta happens to be an unknown number. It is just unknown parameter, unknown number. So here this conditional thing, it will be replaced by just unknown number. We are taking semicolon. That means here this one is, here right now it is a conditional property, but here it is not a conditional property. That means here H1 is involved with parameter theta, and that happens to be unknown to us. So that theta is just a number, unknown number. Here likewise the theta associated with H0 is unknown number. Okay, so unknown number, only that criteria is coming. In that case we are taking the ratio of this property. From the classical perspective, again it is a likelihood ratio of two likelihood function. So we are saying that it is a likelihood ratio, and this, if this likelihood ratio is greater than this threshold, then we will support H0, and if it is less than if it is greater than this threshold value, will support H1, otherwise will support H0. So that's why it is directly giving a numerical computation. So one example I will discuss in next class. So it is already about 45 minutes. Anyone is having any question? You